Hello everyone. So today we'll be discussing the radiology of the lower limb. We'll be seeing the x-rays of hip joint, the knee joint, the ankle joint and the foot. Right? Before we start, let's get a brief idea of how we go about it. First of all, we need to know a couple more names by which x-rays are known. It's also called a radiograph or a skiagram. Right? So how do we study a skiagram? First of all, while explaining a skiagram, we need to mention the view in which it's taken. It could be an AP view or a PA view or a lateral view or a dorsoplantar view. These are some of the views that we use in lower limb. We'll see each of them as we go along and we'll discuss them individually along with their x-rays. Then secondly, we need to mention the bones that we see in the x-ray, right? So the bones and some of their general features we need to mention. Then we move on to the joints that we can see in the radiograph. The normal joint spaces, the bones forming the joints, and the type of the joint. That is what we need to describe. Then why are we studying x-rays? For that we need to look into the clinical side of things as always. We can identify a displacement of a joint in a x-ray. Then we can also identify whether a bone is fractured. We can see whether there's an infective condition in the bone, for example, an osteomyelitis. Then there can be degenerative conditions such as osteoarthritis. There can be neoplasms of the bone, or there can be certain deficiency disorders like rickets or scurvy that we can identify on the x-rays of the bones, right? There's also a medico-legal aspect to x-rays which we can identify the age of the subject by looking at the age of the bone, by knowing whether the epiphyses are fused or not, and that's how we determine the age of the bone. Now moving on to the hip joint. Right here we have the AP view of the hip joint, and what bones we can identify right here. Let's see, here we have the hip bone, then the femur. In the midline, we see the sacrum and some of the lower lumbar vertebrae, right? To discuss some of the general features of these bones, let's look at this. This is the ilium part of the hip bone. We can see this is the iliac crest. This right here, we have the anterior superior iliac spine. Just below it, we have the anterior inferior iliac spine. And on the posterior aspect, we have posterior superior and posterior inferior iliac spines respectively, right? Moving down from the posterior inferior iliac spine, we have the greater sciatic notch, and then right here we have the ischial spine. Okay, now here we can see the superior pubic ramus, the body of the pubis, the conjoint ischiopubic ramus, and right here we have the ischial tuberosity, right? This right here, as all of you can see, this is the acetabular cup, and it is housing the head of the femur, right? The globular head of femur is articulating with the acetabulum. Then we have the neck of the femur, the greater trochanter, the lesser trochanter, and the upper part of the shaft of the femur. Right, these are some of the general features of the bones that we can see right here. Now let's have a look at some of the joints that we can see here. Between the ilium and the sacrum, we have the sacroiliac joint. Everybody knows this is a plane variety of synovial joint. Then in the midline, we have symphysis pubis or the pubic symphysis, which is secondary type of cartilaginous joint. And the third joint we can see here is between the head of the femur and the acetabulum. This is a typical ball and socket variety of synovial joint, right? Another joint we can see here which can be asked is between the vertebrae, and this is also a secondary type of cartilaginous joint, the intervertebral joint, right? So now let's discuss some of the special features that we need to mention in an x-ray of a hip joint. So right here we have the neck shaft angle, which is obviously between the neck of the femur and the shaft of the femur. It is usually 125 degrees in adult males, but in children it can be up to 140 or even 160 degrees, and it is lesser in females, right? Talking of the neck shaft angle, right here we have calcare femoral. It is a dense plate of compact bone present right in front of the lesser trochanter, and it strengthens the neck shaft angle. It also transmits the weight from the head of the femur to the shaft along the linea aspera, right? Then on the upper border of the neck of the femur, we have cervical torus, which is found between the head of the femur and the tip of the greater trochanter. It is another band of compact bone which supports the neck of the femur. It strengthens the neck of the femur, right? Then we also have a Shenton's line. It's a curved line which is formed in part by the upper margin of the obturator foramen and in part by the lower margin of the neck of the femur, right? This is the curved line, which is known as Shenton's line. What is the significance of Shenton's line? If in an X-ray we see that the Shenton's line is broken or is discontinuous, that means there is either displacement of the head of the femur or there's a fracture of the neck of the femur, right? That will break the Shenton's line. So this can happen either in case of displacement or fracture or in certain conditions such as Perthes disease, which can cause a breakage or discontinuity of Shenton's line. Then moving on to Ward's triangle. Ward's triangle is a triangular space present in the shaft, in the neck of the femur, not in the shaft, in the neck of the femur. It is formed by intersection of the trabeculae, the compressive and the tensile trabeculae that we've learned in the general anatomy, that traverse through the neck of the femur. Let's look at this picture and this will give us a better understanding of the Ward's triangle. So right here we have the tensile group of trabeculae that go through the neck like this. Then we have the principal compressive group of trabeculae and the secondary compressive group of trabeculae. So this Ward's triangle right here, this is formed by intersection between the tensile group of trabeculae and the principal and secondary group of compressive trabeculae, right? This is the Ward's triangle. Then we have the Nelaton's line. Nelaton's line, it extends from the anterior superior iliac spine to the ischial tuberosity, and the greater trochanter of the femur, this lies either on the line or below it. This line is drawn when the patient or the subject is in supine position from the anterior superior iliac spine to the ischial tuberosity. What is the significance of this line? When the greater trochanter is above, if the greater trochanter is somewhere here, if it crosses the Nelaton's line, that means there is upward displacement of the head of the femur, right? If the head of the femur is displaced upwards, the greater trochanter will move upwards and it will cross the Nelaton's line. This is usually only seen in lateral X-rays, lateral view X-rays. It is not so prominent in AP view X-rays. Alright, then there's another line known as Shoemaker's line. So the Shoemaker's line, to get a better understanding, we'll see it traverses the greater trochanter, the tip of the greater trochanter, and crosses the anterior superior iliac spine and moves beyond. The Shoemaker's lines of both the sides, they will intersect either at the umbilicus or just above the umbilicus in normal patients. in case of a displacement, in case of an upward displacement of the head and the trochanter, what will happen is that these, if for example the greater trochanter lies here, then the line will come like this, and the line here, it will come like this, and the intersection point will come just below the umbilicus. And so let's discuss another triangle here. It's also drawn in the supine position, and the name of the triangle is Bryant's triangle. So the Bryant's triangle is a right triangle, and the hypotenuse extends from the ASIS to the tip of the greater trochanter. A perpendicular drawn from the ASIS to the horizontal, and then an intersecting line. Right, so this triangle, this right angle triangle, this is the Bryant's triangle. It has the same significance. It shows whether or not the femur, the head of the femur, or the trochanter of the femur is displaced from its normal location, and can also indicate certain other pathologies like Perthes disease or fracture of the neck of the femur. So we've been talking a lot about fracture of the neck of the femur. Let's get a brief idea of what's that like. Now the fracture of the neck of the femur, it can be of three types. It can be either subcapital, which is just below the head of the femur, capitis meaning head, and then subcapital, just below the head. Then there is cervical, so right through the middle of the neck of the femur, and then we have basal type of fracture of neck of femur, which is more closer to the trochanters of the femur, right? So these are the three types of fracture of neck of femur. These fractures and dislocations, they can cause certain conditions which will alter the angle, the neck shaft angle of the femur. These can be coxa valga or coxa vara. Coxa valga is usually increase in angle of the neck shaft, which is usually beyond 139 degrees. It is usually seen in a congenital dislocation of the hip joint. They can be coxa vara, which is decrease in the neck shaft angle. This is seen in fractures of the neck of the femur, or can be seen in Perthes disease, which is. So now let's move on to the x-ray of the knee joint. Right here we can see we have two views of the knee joint. On the left side we have the AP view, and on the right side we have the lateral view. We can identify four bones here: the femur, the lower end of femur, we have the upper end of tibia and fibula, and then in front of the femur we can see a shadow of the patella. So how do we identify which sided lower limb it is? We can see that the fibula will always be on the lateral side. Since this is an AP view, so we'll see the posterior structures first. So the patella will be on the interior side, right behind the femur here. The tibia is on the medial side. So this is right sided lower limb, and this is the AP view x-ray. Alright, on the lateral view x-ray we can much more easily identify the patella. So which x-ray is better for viewing patella? It is the lateral view of the knee joint. We've identified four bones here. Now we also need to identify the joints we can see here. We have our knee joint, but another joint we can see here is the superior tibiofibular joint. Alright, the tibiofibular joint. Now what type of joint is knee joint? It is a modified hinge joint, functionally speaking. But the joint between the patella and the femur, it is a saddle variety of synovial joint, right? And the joint between the condyles of the femur and the condyles of the tibia, it is condylar variety of joint. Why is it known as a modified variety of hinge joint? Because the movements are not only in one axis, the flexion and extension, it is accompanied by rotation, right? The locking and the unlocking of knee, everyone has read that. So now let's discuss some of the general features we can see here. We can see the lower part of shaft of femur. then we can see the upper part of shaft of tibia. We can see the lateral and the medial condyles, lateral and the medial condyles of femur and tibia respectively. Then we can see the head, neck and upper part of shaft of fibula. In between the two condyles of the femur, we have the intercondylar notch. And in between the two condyles of tibia, we have the intercondylar eminence. These are some of the general features we can see on the anterior posterior view of the x-ray. And then on the lateral view, we can also identify this right here. What is this? This is the tibial tuberosity. Another bone that can be sometimes present here is fibula. Fibula is another rounded sesamoid bone that is present in the lateral head of gastrocnemius. So it should be present somewhere here, and it articulates with the posterior surface of the lateral condyle of femur, right? It measures about 1.5 centimeters in diameter, and it's only present in about 15% of individuals. It is almost always bilateral. It is usually presented between 12 to 15 years of age. Another thing we might see sometimes is presence of a bipartite patella. A bipartite patella is also almost always bilateral. It is the separation of the superolateral angle of the patella. So the superolateral part of the patella, it fails to fuse with the rest of the patella, and that is usually due to the failure of fusion of ossific centers, and it may be confused with a fracture of the patella. But how can we differentiate between a fractured patella and a bipartite patella is the margins of the non-fused part in a bipartite patella will be smooth, whereas in a fracture, the margins of the fractured bone would be serrated. And also, the bipartite patella will be bilateral. It will be present on both sides, whereas a fractured patella is more likely to be on the one side which is affected. Another defect or anomaly in patella can be emargination of patella. Emargination of patella is the outer margin is concave, or the lateral margin that is concave. It is bounded by a tubercle above and a spine below. It basically reflects the attachment, the mode of attachment of vastus lateralis. So another important aspect to note in a knee x-ray is the joint space between the two condyles, the condyles of the femur and the condyles of the tibia. The joint space, it is inversely proportional to age, as it is said. So what does that mean is, as the age increases, the space between the joint decreases, right? Another thing we can notice here is the epiphyseal line. So this is a relatively younger person, so the fusion has not completely taken place. Now moving on to the x-ray of the ankle joint and the foot. Right here we have the x-ray of the left foot, and on the left side you can see this is the dorsoplantar view, and on the right side we have the oblique lateral view. Right, this is not a complete lateral view, otherwise the metatarsals and the phalanges would have been hidden behind the others, whereas here we have the oblique lateral view so that we can appreciate them separately. Alright, so let's identify the bones here. We have the phalanges the most distally. On the greater toe we have two phalanges, but in the rest we have three phalanges each. Then we have the metatarsals, the first, second, third, fourth and fifth, right? Then we have the three cuneiform bones, the medial, intermediate and lateral, right? Then we have the navicular bone, which is seen on this oblique lateral view as well. This is better appreciated here. Then we have the cuboid bone. Then we have the calcaneum, and above it the talus. Then we also have the lower ends of the tibia and the fibula. All right. So these are the bones that we can identify here. we also have certain sesamoid bones that are present here. First, we have two sesamoid bones which are usually present at the base metatarsal on the plantar surface, right? And we can also have sesamoid bones in tibialis anterior, tibialis posterior, or peroneus longus. There are also certain accessory bones present sometimes. Right here we do not have any accessory bones, but we can have an os trigonum, which is the lateral tubercle of talus. When it is non-ossified, it presents as an accessory bone. And we also have an os vesellinium, which is the tubercle of the fifth metatarsal, which is not completely ossified along with the fifth metatarsal, right? Then let's have a look at the joints. We can see here we have the interphalangeal joints, which are the hinge variety of joints, obviously. Then we have the talocalcaneonavicular joint. This is an important joint because this is a ball and socket variety of joint. There are only four ball and socket variety of joints in the whole body, and this is one of them, talocalcaneonavicular joint. Alright. Then we have the tarsometatarsal joints, the tarsometatarsal joints, and the intermetatarsal joints. These are plane variety of synovial joints, and the calcaneocuboid joint, the joint between calcaneum and the cuboid bone. This is saddle variety of synovial joint. Alright, so these are the joints which are present here. Obviously, the ankle joint is a hinge variety of joint. If we see certain clinical anatomy related to the ankle joint x-ray or the foot x-ray, we have a march fracture. The march fracture, as the name identifies, it usually happens in individuals who are marching, such as the ones in army or the ones who have an occupation which forces them to stand for a long time, such as doctors or construction workers, something like that, right? It is a fracture in the distal one third of the metatarsals. Typically in the second metatarsal, but it can affect any of the metatarsals. So in the distal one third of the metatarsals, right? Then there is Pott's fracture, which is fracture of one or both malleoli. It occurs due to landing on foot from a high jump. So if you jump from the first floor balcony, for example, and land on your feet, so it might fracture one or both of your malleolus of the tibia and the fibula, and that's known as Pott's fracture. So this is all about radiology for the lower limb, and best of luck for your part ending exam for lower limb. Hope to see you guys soon. Thank you.